Here's to the crazy ones, the misfits, the rebels, the troublemakers, the round pegs in the square holes, the ones who see things differently. They're not fond of rules, and they have no respect for the status quo. You can quote them, disagree with them, glorify or vilify them. About the only thing you can't do is ignore them. Because they change things. They push the human race forward. And while some may see them as the crazy ones, we see genius. Because the people who are crazy enough to think they can change the world are the ones who do.
Yemen, where the country mourned the untimely death of Yemeni writer, activist, and HuffPost Live community member Ibrahim Monthana. Monthana died on Thursday at the age of just 24. His cause of death is currently unknown, but a blog for the Middle East Institute reports that he might have died of heart attack. Monthana was a prominent voice in the Yemenis group youth-led uprising, which began in 2011. He was also the co-founder of the Watan Party and Arab Thought Foundation's 2011 ambassador.
How far do you think a child can go in his life or her life when the right to play is taken away? We grew up in the 10th section of Hebron, a city in the southern Palestinian territories, where at some points of my childhood, curfews were imposed by a strong military presence. Despite the fact that we were growing up under occupation, peace to us as kids meant our right to play freely, to have fun, and to feel safe. I wanted to be the man, the voice, the man with the camera shooting the story with the lens, not with bullets. By the time I was 11, my city, Hebron, was invaded at the beginning of the second Palestinian uprising. I built my first camera, and the first lens I looked through was made of Legos. I'm not sure if any of you have experienced tear gas bombs, but at that day, I survived being choked from tear gas bombs. But when a young journalist sees that he can lead, at that time, he has to form a special path. The first week, I took office as an elected youth mayor in Hebron. In 2006, I mobilized a group of youth to report news and to write our opinions in public. I can't describe to you how amazing and unique that feeling of seeing this forum of young voices reflecting different opinions and ambitious dreams. Over 5 years of operating since that time, thousands of students were involved in such programs. Last year, while reporting on clashes and demonstrations in my city, Hebron, I was attacked by Israeli policemen. I had never experienced such a brutal physical attack and had never been in jail. For the first time, my hands and legs were being cuffed. It wasn't only a cuff that held my legs or hands. I felt that my freedom of expression and my right to perform my duty were being cuffed. If holding my camera and opening my lens the record and so the world. The conflict that I have been growing up, witnessing it, would lead me to jail. I was very proud to be there for the sake of defending the freedom of expression and our right to know and tell the story. Six days in detention challenged me to rethink my commitment to my own message of peace and understanding. At first, I regretted every single moment I spent trying to understand the other side or care about a compromised solution of the Israeli-Palestinian conflict. But then, I remembered moments when I met my Israeli peers and saw that there was no difference in the way we perceived the future of our region. These moments made me believe in the potential of people working together to lead our region toward peace and prosperity. Remembering some moments where not only there was no difference, but there was the same dreams in which we perceived our rules in this region. When I was released on the sixth day, and I realized the support of brothers and sisters from around the world, I learned one thing: our unlimited love, our unlimited understanding, and empathy with each other. Because there is one simple fact that unifies our generation: our common longing for a peaceful world, and our hope for a bright future for ourselves and our children.
هنالك شخص آخر سيتساءل ولكن استخدام الإنترنت في اليمن محدود لماذا تريد استخدام الإنترنت كوسيلة هنالك سببان السبب الأول هو أني أرى هذا الشيء كفرصة لا كعقبة يعني نحن الآن نعيش ازدياد كبير جدا لمستخدمي الإنترنت في اليمن يعني في إحصائية أخيرة يعني تجاوزت النسبة 15% بينما كانت 5% قبل 5 سنوات من الآن بالإضافة إلى ذلك أنا أرى في التلفون السيار أو المحمول فعلا أداة ستحدث نقلة نوعية ليس فقط في اليمن ولكن في مجتمعات العالم الثالث بلا استثناء هنالك أكثر من 12 مليون مستخدم للهاتف النقال هذا أكثر من عدد من يملكون بطاقات انتخابية أنا أريد بعد 3 أو 4 سنوات من الآن ومع زيادة الاستخدام ونقص أسعار الهواتف الذكية بأن يكون لدى كل مواطن أداة للتواصل مع صانع القرار في يده إذا أردت أن أتحدث أو إذا أردت أن أشتكي كل ما أريده هو أن أخذ كاميرا الموبايل وأتحدث فيها وميزة هذا أننا في اليمن في بلد يتجاوز فيه الأمية 50% سأستطيع أن أستفيد أيضا من الكم الكبير من الحكمة الذي يوجد لدى بعض الأشخاص الأميين بعض الأشخاص قد لا يكون لديهم الفرصة لم تكن لديهم الفرصة للتعلم ولكنهم يعرفون الكثير ولديهم الكثير من الحكمة بالنهاية لن نستطيع أن ننهض لا يمكن لشخص واحد أو اثنين أو مجموعة واحدة أن تنهض بالوطن كله في الختام أقول لكم يعني قد تكون هذه خطوة صغيرة ولكن كما يقال أو بالأصح بالأحرى أن يقال الآن طريق الألف ميل قد تبدأ بتعليق على الفيسبوك أو فيديو على اليوتيوب شكرا جزيلا
What's up? My name is Musa. I'm from Iraq. I work as a youth advocate for the Iraq Health Aid Organization and we do a lot of work with social media involving creating awareness in our country. Unfortunately, a lot of our followers already believe in the message of activism and social inclusion. My social inclusion projects focus on disability advocacy, also youth awareness and youth involvement. My criticism mainly of social media awareness lies in the fact that it's a bubble, in the sense that a lot of activists are already on there, and the majority of the population is not on there. Fix that by creating more internet availability for rural areas as well as urban areas. I think it's a really great tool, and it created catalysts for many for the revolutions, mainly because it helped activists organize and arrange their activities. This was true for Egypt, and it was also true for Tunisia and other revolutions across the Middle East. Personally, going forward, I think activists should use social media to increase their presence on the ground, because they can arrange activities together. And we've seen many leaders such as Muna Al-Tahawi and others across the region who have really become proponents of the revolutions and of many liberties that have been popularized by other countries. And I think there is a newfound of democracy that's taking place in the Middle East that even supersedes the one in Western countries, because it promotes access to information that is ignored in Western countries, because it's as if taken for granted, as if it's already available. So there's nothing more, there's no more information to be kept from the public, but there are many types of information that are kept from the public. With several organizations such as the Global Changemakers, shout out to my Global Changemakers, and also with 3.Dash as a peace ambassador, shout out to the GTLs, and that is all. Thank you for listening. This has been News from Iraq. Sup, Sara.
I personally think that without social media and new technologies, that the social movements and revolutions in the Middle East and North Africa would have been, to a certain extent, much more difficult to organize. So as an organizing tool, it's been a great space for debate and discussion. However, it's hard to look at it in such a fully utopian perspective, as some of the discourse may sound like, simply because, as always, the internet is a two-way mirror where forces of oppression can also use it. The other point that I'd like to make is about how new media has become a new source towards citizen journalism, and how much of a rise that has caused in what is considered credible, what isn't considered credible. For example, the Egyptian Revolution, there was a lot of checking social media websites for updates and what is happening, rather than news channels. It's not right to say that there hasn't been a rise in the blogger sphere, for example, and the sharing of YouTube videos of like state oppression prior to 2011, prior to all these revolutions, because they have begun. And this is where sometimes it's been mistakenly reported that a lot of these revolutions and social movements were kind of out of the blue, all of a sudden kind of things, where they've been boiling up for several years. However, like, the less utopian view is that there's more people that are now skeptical of this whole idea of digital or keyboard activism, where they're worried that it doesn't translate, especially because there's such a huge divide between who has access and who doesn't have access in the Middle East and North Africa. There's sometimes even difficulty communicating or misunderstanding between two different generations, or the same generation that has or does not have access to new media technology. So it's highly important, I believe, especially in the next few years, to use these tools as weapons of activism, but also to make sure that there's space, and this is something that youth have to really put forward on the ground.
Hi, my name is Ghalia. I live in Jordan. As a youth activist, I do all sorts of voluntary work, especially with the Jordan River Foundation. We would fix public schools in the less fortunate areas of Amman. First of all, there's no doubt that social media has improved freedom of speech and promoted women's rights, not only in the Middle East, but also globally. I do agree that the Arab Revolution has become the revolution of the young, as we can see from the Arab Spring in most of the region countries, especially in Egypt and in Syria. But I don't completely agree that social media can be used for oppression by the authoritarian governments. For instance, in Jordan, the government is doing nothing against the social media or against their people's desires, while in other countries, they're putting limitations and restrictions on some social media sites due to some cultural beliefs. They also limit the freedom of speech in politics. There has been some minor improvements in the past, but I'm hoping for more improvements in the future. Social media also plays a large role when it comes to spreading messages. I worked in a campaign the last year. We were raising awareness on family planning. Other than visiting local stores in each district of Jordan, we would send our messages through Facebook, and the results were very positive.
Hello. My name is Ali, I'm from the Kingdom of Bahrain. I've noticed many development initiatives and programs using social media as an outlet to promote information and raise awareness for programs that benefit youth, women, and other stakeholders, which I think is very positive. Social media has made it much easier to reach out to the bigger population, both locally and internationally. For example, marketing entrepreneurship workshops to guide youth on how to run a business.
Hi, my name is Hiba, and I am a social activist here in Kuwait. Over the years, I've seen the popularity of social media absolutely skyrocket in the Middle East, and especially in Kuwait, because we saw firsthand through the Arab Spring just how social media can be used as such a positive tool for change. So as a social activist, I definitely use this to my advantage, and I found that Facebook, Twitter, and Instagram has been so very useful to get my message across. So in 2011, I started the Kuwait chapter of the international youth movement called the I Am Challenge. Now basically, this youth movement encourages youngsters to take on the challenge of wearing a shirt that says I Am and their name for one whole year everywhere they go. And this is done in an attempt to break the cycle of materialism and basically to challenge the youngsters to not think about what they look like for a whole year, but instead spend that time thinking about issues larger than themselves. Now, this concept was so foreign in Kuwait because I grew up in a society in Kuwait where we're just so brand conscious. We care so much about what we look like. So to get this message across, we needed to do something special. You know, we can't just go to schools and talk about, you know, what we're doing. So instead we used Facebook. We created a Facebook page, and this was very helpful because instead of just telling people what we do and why we're doing it, we used Facebook to connect ourselves to the other teams around the world who are doing the same thing. So we showed the youth in Kuwait how kids our same age in New Zealand or kids our same age in Thailand are doing the same thing. So it brought us all together, brought the youth all around the world together. So Facebook was a very, very useful tool in getting the message across. And another important issue in Kuwait is that of a language barrier that exists between the expats and the Arabs and the locals. Initially, most of the members in my youth movement were actually non-Arabs, and we found it very difficult to reach out to the local kids because we couldn't speak Arabic, you know. So how exactly could we tell them about what we're doing, and how could we encourage them to join on board? So In that sense, Facebook was very useful because on Facebook, everybody speaks in English. So when we put up our Facebook page, so we got a lot of interest from the locals as well. And that's how we were able to reach out to the Kuwaiti students and to the other Arab students. And it was very, very useful. We also used YouTube in our campaign. We created a YouTube video about the different things that we do, about why exactly we're wearing the same shirt for a whole year, and the different campaigns that we've done together as a team. And this YouTube video went viral in a couple of days, and not only did it gain a lot of popularity in Kuwait, but it also gained a lot of popularity in the Middle East. So within a week, we got messages from youngsters in Egypt and Tunisia who also wanted to make teams in their own countries. So in this way, social media has been very, very, very useful in spreading our message across. And to be honest, I don't think without social media, our message would have been as popular as it is today in Kuwait.
To the world, it is the 25th of January, but to me, it is the 6th of June. Last year, on that day, I woke up with a friend calling me to say that Khaled, a guy who lived just two blocks away from me, died yesterday while sitting in a cyber cafe. Two police officers broke into the place, asked everyone to show their IDs just because the country is under emergency law. And when he refused to be treated in this way, they dragged him out of the cafe, beat him to death, and leave him die in the streets. The friends of Khaled Saeed did not remain silent. They created a Facebook group called We're All Khaled Saeed to advocate for actions and peaceful protests that would make the government pay attention to what happened to Khaled. But the government did not listen. Nothing, no actions were taken. 6 months after Khaled's death, Tunisia had its revolution. And while the Tunisian revolution was going, the admins of Khaled Saeed group created a Facebook event for the 25th of January to be a day of peaceful protests against unemployment, corruption, and police brutality in Egypt. On the 25th, there were just a couple of hundreds in the streets, but by the 28th, there were 90,000 Egyptians registered attending on Facebook. And by the time the revolution continued, there were millions of Egyptians on the streets. Now the question is, how did the revolution happen? How can we use social media to make such impact? One of my favorite quotes is, "Never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it's the only thing that ever has." Now the small group of citizens in our case are the Egyptian youth of the internet. Only 26% of Egypt is on the internet, and much less than this number is in the social network, whether Facebook or Twitter we're talking about. This small percentage had to force the government to shut down all mobile and network connections for 5 days, just to stop people from protesting. Although people protested and put down governments even before social media and internet existed, now with these new tools we can have the same impact with much less time and with much less effort. Okay, social media is effective, but what do we actually mean by effective? Did anyone think that social media can be used to bring down political systems? Was it even imagined that it would trigger protests all around the Arab regions from Libya, Yemen to Syria? Was it even thinkable that we can have protests in Wisconsin and inspired by ones in Egypt just because there was a medium of social media existing? Before the revolution started, I always felt threatened that I could get arrested at any moment just because my country is under emergency law. I never been to voting because I know that my voice will not count. I lost hope in change, and when the revolution started, I was one of the people who were desperate at the beginning that this revolution is going to change anything. I was not with great hopes in this revolution. And if this revolution taught me anything, then it's that once you lose hope, you're almost there to succeed. If the people who started this revolution were already losing hope in the country, nothing would have happened. You just need to be brave enough to take the first step, and then the rest will follow. Last time I was in New York, I was in a cafe with Huda Dash, and a girl came up to me asking, "Where do I live in the States?" And I said, "No, I'm from Egypt." So she got so excited that in my mind, I was like, didn't know that girls here like Egyptian guys. But then she said, oh my God, you live in a pyramid. And I was like, no, I don't live in a pyramid. We don't have friends anymore in the country. We're just, pyramids are just there to take pictures. And when that happened, at that moment, I realized that people in the US do not know that much about my country. And this changed after the revolution. Now everyone is Googling and tweeting about Egypt. Everyone is talking about the revolution, Facebook and Twitter.
Hi, my name is Mai, and I've been using Facebook and social media since I was a teenager. I agree that many people, and many young people especially these days, are using social media much more than before, and that they can reach and have an impact on the world that they wouldn't have if there was not Facebook. For example, the Arab Spring, or the women's revolution in Arab countries that wanted to drive and couldn't do that till now. Although it didn't succeed, they have changed something in people's mindsets, and they got to people they wouldn't be able to get to, created events for women's rights and published them. I live in a special village, where Jews and Palestinians live together in Israel. It's the only place where people actually chose to live together. And I could publish that to people, write it on my profile so it will get to other people as much as possible. And I think that today the message or what you have to say can get to so much more people with the social media.
Social media in the Middle East has greatly improved women's rights and has been a catalyst for change in the Middle East. The youth have used Facebook and Twitter to organize people on the streets, to share and distribute information, and rally the support to try and change the government, the policies, and really improve society. Harassment is an organization that lets people on the street report cases of sexual harassment or any kind of street harassment via text message. And this can help society, even law enforcement, understand and see where cases are occurring the most. Other organizations are helping fighting against harassment, sexual abuse, empowering women to get their rights. And this is all coming together through works in social media.
Hi, my name is Derek Anishong, aka DNA. I'm the former host of The Stream on Al Jazeera English. I would definitely agree with the statement that social media and satellite media are transforming the political and cultural social landscape in the Middle East. For one, satellite media is doing so because it enables people to transcend the traditionally controlled media, what some would argue are propaganda wings of various governments. And social media is transformative because it gives people, average people, a voice on things that are happening in the societies and a way to organize and find like-minded individuals that would otherwise be more difficult, though not impossible. The thing that I think is important to consider as we look forward is that the revolutions that happened during the Arab Spring were definitely not social media revolutions. I mean, real people took to the streets, real people made sacrifices, and that is what enabled those revolutions to take place. But the second and arguably the more important point is that the revolution or revolutions are not over. This is an ongoing process, and we shouldn't be too quick to try to find an end result. Any revolution takes time, and what is truly revolutionary, I think, is not simply the change of government, but the change of the role of the citizen in the public sphere and the demanding of those citizens of greater rights and a greater voice. And I think social and satellite media are a huge part of both.
Somebody's lack of love. if you say what you want to say.
Somebody's lack of love.